Well, welcome back to the Strong Opinion Hibs podcast. I'm your host for this evening, Charlie, and I'm joined firstly by Calvin. Calvin, how you doing, mate?
I'm doing well, mate. Good to be back on it. Looking forward to chatting with you both.
Good. And we're joined by Aidan as well. Jack's just back for Germany, so he's giving us a miss. So, Aidan, how are you doing, mate?
I'm good, mate. How are you?
Aye, not bad. It would be better if Hibs won on the weekend, but apart from that, I'm all right. So, aye, we're going to talk about Saturday, talk about the general direction of the club, and then do a wee bit on the women's team as well, because they're doing a lot better than the men just now. So firstly, Calvin, I'll come to you first. Saturday away to Killy, before the game, were you hoping that we'd turn this bad form into a win?
Mate, I put full faith in my dog. The wee man, Hibs, through and through, full confidence in Lee Johnson, didn't even give the Kilmarnock dog bowl a second look. Straight in for the Hibs victory, and I thought, okay, what, this first of me. But unfortunately, it was too keen. Too young, I'll put it down there, was just too young, only a year old, so he's got a lot of learning to go away. I think the first year he was with us was when Hibs finished third, so he expects good things, old Doug. But nah, mate, I put my full confidence in him, eh? And I thought Hibs would have won it. I really do. I thought Hibs could have had enough. But to be honest with you, I was just thinking, like, when is this roller coaster going to stop? Like, surely we aren't actually going, like, through, like, another bad patch, like Maloney-esque, Jack Ross-esque at the end. I think surely no, like surely it's got just a bit of luck and it's got to turn eh? So I was kind of feeling like we were going to win it, eh? I had Ian Gordon doing his first score today. I thought it was quite funny on Twitter, but I think I was the only one. But nah.
Aye.
Not surprised, mate.
But remember, mate, your pug's the reason we lost, so...
100%, mate. He's been locked in his cage for a week. So he has to do better, mate.
It's the best place for him. Aidan, were you confident going into the game, or were you, after Tuesday's defeat to Ross County, were you expecting a defeat, or what were you thinking?
I was a bit nervous, to be fair. I remember seeing the lineup and being like, what's going on here? Like, I didn't know what I thought, to be honest. I remember just seeing the lineup and being like, I didn't feel confident from that moment. I don't know why that is as well either, because as you both know, I love Lee Johnson. I think he's a good manager and I think he'll take us places, but I've seen the lineup and I just, like, there was no confidence in me. And I don't know if that was still because of the county result. Like, I went into county expecting us to win anyway. But I think, I just didn't feel great about it at all.
Yeah. I agree. When I seen the team, we'll come on to the team lineup in a second, but I was confident going into it. I think we seem to always do well against Killy, but obviously was not to be. But let's talk about the team lineup then. So we had Marshall in goal, Cabrera at left back, Hanlon and Portress centre backs, Cadden right back, Stevenson. I'm going based off the foot mob lineup here. Stevenson, Kenna, Newell and Campbell in the midfield, and Kukarevich and Melkerson up front. Gaydon, what happened there? What's that lineup all about?
Like, the Stevenson thing threw me off when I first seen it. So I thought it was going to be a 3-5-2 with Stevenson centre-back. When I first read it, I thought, all right, okay. And then having Cabrera and Cadden in the wings. And you know, just like with normal, like a normal, like, when you look at that, you think, that's where we're going to line up. But I don't know, like, I think it just threw me completely because we had, what, Stevenson, Hanlon, Porto, Cabrera, Cadden, Kenny, six defensive-minded players on that pitch against Killy. And I just kind of looked at it and, yeah, I think that's probably what threw the nerves a little bit, seeing so many, like, defensive players against a team like Killy. It didn't seem that attacking. But right, apparently we play attacking football, so...
Aye, it definitely was a defensive-minded formation. Calvin, what did you think when you seen it?
It's almost like back to names at a hat, eh? Sort of esque. But to be honest with you, I was delighted to see Melkerson start up front. I've kind of thought to myself the last couple of weeks, I'd like to see Melkerson play through the middle, because it just looks like his movement's very good up front. And I think the run he made against, as at Aberdeen when we got the goal back, like, his movement in that is very, very good. And I think the way, obviously, when he scored the two against Motherwell last season, the way he can just nip in front of a defender, I feel like we've just been missing that. Just someone to get on the end of a ball. So when I seen Melkerson starting up front, I thought, aye, that's pretty good, that, actually. But as the game went on, you know, there was less and less, the shots added up, and unfortunately, we never converted. For me, there's no creative midfielder. I said we needed a creative midfielder back in the summer. I mean, you're laughing at me, right? I thought that team had enough to win it. I think that team had enough to win that game. Back five is fair enough. Cabrera, Hanlon, Portes, Cadden. I'm surprised Rocky's been dropped unless he's carrying an injury. Marshall and goals, can't he complain? The midfield's sceptical to me. Why is he... I mean, Henderson needs a run in the team. Don't get me wrong, I'm not his biggest fan, and I think he has put... I think he's had a... I don't think he's been very good at all, to be honest with you. I think his decision-making's quite poor. I think his delivery into the box is quite poor as well, and he's all just looks very, very rusty, but he needs a run of games. Like, so I don't really know. But to see him dropped for Stevenson coming into the team, Campbell starting as well, I was just surprised to see that McCurdy never started. I mean, we've signed this boy, we're needing goals, let bygones be bygones. He said what he said, you know what I mean? Let him prove and let him do his talking on the pitch. I'd like to have seen him on earlier, because when he came on, I thought he was probably the only one that goes past marks. It's him and Melkerson. I thought he looked very lively when he came on. And something I noticed about him, he could get the ball at his feet and run at folk. And that's something I think we missed. So now, just that lineup, eh? Like, that midfield's taking you nowhere, by the way. Stevenson left mid, looks like Campbell right mid, and two in the middle, Kenny and Newell. You're laughing at me, mate, but we've let better players go. We've let better players go. There's no one in that midfield to feed to that can play a forward pass and break a defence through. Mate, he's got Alan a call. Get him on the blower, I'm telling you.
We'll see him at Easter Road this weekend.
Bad mistake, mate.
Aye, we'll see him at Easter Road this weekend, mate, in the charity game, so you'll be able to watch him play the glorious through balls again. But, I mean, I agree in terms of the team. Like, I feel like Rocky was dropped for nothing. He's not put a foot wrong all season. He's at the team. I like, though, that I think going back to the two centre-backs to the three is a good idea, but I would have dropped Porteous. Yeah. Porteous hasn't put a foot right since that Ross County game. I think
the last two games he's got a match rating lower than four, which is like...
That says it all. But, let's come on to the first half then. To be honest, I was at the game, my dad, my brother. The game was so boring. We were so bad to watch. But the only real talking point of the first half is the VAR decision that went against us, which is nothing new there. Melkerson, is he offside? You can see, I don't know if you've seen the pictures, but the lines are on top of each other. I can't tell if that's offside. The ref can't tell. Douglas Ross and the other line, can't tell. How can VAR tell that's offside? They can't.
I don't think they can. I don't think... I've watched it so many times now, and I just didn't... I don't think it is. Like, maybe that's saying that wrong. I think he... A wee bit, but, like, the size of my nail, offside. Like, there's no way with a naked eye, or even with VAR, you can look at that and think... Yeah, it's definitely off. But then there's that... We all knew this sort of stuff was going to happen when we brought VAR in. Like, we all knew that these sort of moments would happen, so it just seems to be happening to us so often. And I kind of feel sorry for Cucurella, because every any time he scores, seems to be offside just now.
We're verging on the Celtic conspiracy theory here with the VAR, but it's only us and Celtic that really have been affected by it so far.
But doesn't like the colour green.
But I looked at the rule book, and apparently if it's in line, you've got to give it to the attacking team. If you can't even make a clear cut decision, you've got to give it to the attacking team. So by the letter of the law, that should have stood in my book.
I didn't realise that.
Calvin, what does that say a lot about the team just now, that it's just a VAR decision, that's all there is to talk about the first half from us?
I feel like I mean, if you're going to call stuff like that offside, I think the game's gone, man. It's got to be a clear offside for me. I mean, if you're talking a ball here like that, come on. I mean, even if that was Kilmarnock the other way, Ken, surely they'd be screaming for it as well. Do you know what I mean? It's just, genuinely, where do you draw the line with this? Because it is too far. It's way too far. I mean, I think you have to have at least full body part in front. I mean, it is the definition of a ball here, that. Like, that is a definition of a ball here. Like, it must be a knee here. It's crazy.
And even
it's
at that...
It's boring, man. It's boring, eh? To me, that's just...
How often does someone score with their knee as well? Like, I feel like if his foot was offside, then ideal. But it's his knee. Like, you never score with your knee.
I mean, nah, I just think it's very unlucky. And I think when you're down on your luck, kids, you need to sort of catch a break and have something go for you. And just unfortunately, there's nothing going for us. But I think... We'll hopefully get into this later, but it just asks the question, like, where is this poor run of form? Who do you point the finger at, and where does it come to? I mean, do you point the finger at VAR? We've been very unlucky with obviously the one away to Dundee United,
one at Aberdeen.
The referee decision there, the one at Aberdeen, which was an absolute joke as well. That was never a penalty in a million years, and you've got this one here, you've got this one here, and then obviously the penalty as well. Like, I mean, talk about having a bad luck. I mean, it's been terrible. It's seriously unlucky, because I think it definitely affects the player's mood, and I think you can see a real sort of attitude change in them when it isn't going our way. Like against Aberdeen, we felt sorry for ourselves, but we can't afford to do that, unfortunately. And it seems to knock the stuffing out of us rather than try and drive us on and think, Ken, let's smash the ball into the net and say, oh, did that one go in? Do you know what I mean? Like, have a bit of bite about us, but don't know, mate. Don't know what to make of it. I think it's a bit of a joke, and I think I jump in because I'm losing my shit. I've got stuff I want to keep for later.
Aye, anyway, from one VAR decision to another. Another big talking point for the game. Kelly get a penalty early in the second half. Aidan, do you think it was a penalty? Because I'm not convinced it was.
I've just watched it. I still think it's a penalty. Like, I watched it at the time. Oh,
really?
I just think, just with him going back, like, he's going into the back of him. Like, you don't do that.
Aye.
I think his eyes are on the ball, eh? I thought his eyes were on the ball. From where I was
sitting in the ground, it looked like it was outside. Obviously, I'm at the other end of the ground, but it looked like it was outside the box. It's probably marginal.
Right on the edge. It's right on the edge. But it's still, you can't do that. Nah. If I'd done that on a Sunday, my teammates would be momentum. Like, you just can't. You have to be careful in those situations. Like, you know what referees in Scotland are like, especially. You can't just go into the back of someone and he clips his knee a little bit. And I'm like, you've made contact there. You've still went and done that. It's clumsy. I can get what Calvin's saying is that it's soft. It's ridiculously soft. But you're still making contact in the box from behind. Like, you can be looking at the ball, but the ref doesn't know you're sitting and staring at the ball.
I feel like Cabrera doesn't see him coming. I feel like Cabrera doesn't see him coming, and the boy runs across the front of Cabrera. I think Cabrera's trying to clear the ball, and just with him running in front, I think it's just unlucky, and I don't think it's deliberate at all.
Probably right. It's probably not the way, but I think...
Looks like his eyes are on the ball the full time.
Players make the most of it, don't they? And I think that's what the Coy boy's done. I think he's just made the most of it. Seeing Cabrera's probably... It just the way he is, and it just seems like he's kind of... Obviously, from angles, it just looks like he's kind of like put his knee into the back of him. And then the boy just went down. So I get what you mean. It's soft, probably soft. It probably hasn't meant it, but he still put that challenge in that the Kelly players just made the most of it. I can't remember which Kelly player it was, to be honest.
Nah, I can't mind either. But obviously Kelly scored from that, and it definitely put 10 behind the ball. Or even 11 if you include the keeper. But we have so many chances after that. Like, just after that, though, El Harry Juf comes on, Wee McCurdy, with his new...
Yeah, you love that, eh? You're trying to pull that up. I like that. I've seen it a few times. Like,
his third haircut since he joined Hibs. And I was surprised to see him come on the park though, because Johnson was saying he was out until after the World Cup and wasn't mentioning him in his press conferences, but he came on and to be honest, he was the best player on the park for Hibs. And
he was, mate.
And I mean, it does say a lot, doesn't it? Like, Harry McCurdy's not really set the world on fire since he came in, but I think, you know, he was looking to get on the ball. He had that wee chance where he flicked it over his head and it was close. If I had went in, that'd have shut everyone up. That's a beauty of a goal. But yeah. He played well. Henderson came on and was dog awful again. I think time's running out for Henderson at Hibs, if I'm honest.
I think the lad is so low. I don't think time's running out, but I think the lad is so low on confidence, mate. He's so low on confidence. It's unreal.
I was hoping after the goal against St Mirren, though, that would be him kicking on, but it seems like he's...
Even in the St Mirren game, I didn't think he was great. And Stuart, is it Stuart Lovell that's on the commentary as well? Like, he was definitely like hounding him as well, like saying that his decision making's poor, his passing's poor. Like, every time he gets the ball, it's like he can't get ready quick enough. Out of his feet quick enough? He never lifts his head and tries to drive forward or that. Like, he's always like, doesn't he want it? Doesn't he want to make a mistake? So
there was a chance he had towards the end as well, where all he has to do is look up and see that someone's screaming for the ball across the box. He just squares it to him and probably score. And he just balloons it over the bar. And that was it. That sums up Ewan Henderson and a Hibs top for me. He's very quick to make a decision.
But then it wasn't just him that done that either.
No, you're right.
Melkerson done it a few times as well. He got into certain positions and all had to. I think there was a point where he could have squared it to Campbell. And he just took shot.
No, you're absolutely right.
The boy had him. The boy was like covering him. So why not play the ball and give it like the easy option?
Do you think we're trying too hard just to score?
I think so. I think our decision making is really poor in that final third. Really, really poor.
Kind of stating
the obvious, isn't it? When we are having 11 shots and or 17 shots and one on target. But
you're bang
it just
on.
It seems like there's certain like as soon as we get to that, like we're good at getting up the pitch, but it was the same under Maloney and it's now a bit the same under Ross. It's like no one's there to kind of like make that clinical final bash of the ball. I think everyone hoped McGuinness was the answer to that, and then he's away. Obviously, Scott Allen didn't play much, but then he kind of had that kind of ability towards the end of his Hibs career. It's fine with someone who can make
I'll
that
defend, but I'll defend him.
You're hoping, though, that when Nisbet back, we can sort of turn some of these chances in. Like, obviously, like I'm not putting all my eggs in the Nisbet basket because he's had a long
time. We've been there before.
You've seen it where even... Take Scott Allen, for example, came back different player, bad injury that Nisbet's had. McGuinness even as well. You come back for two games and he's one suspended and then injured again. Like, I'm not putting my eggs in the Nisbet basket, but you're hoping that, because he was starting to have a really good run of games before he got injured, unfortunately. You're hoping that when he comes back, even McGeady, Boyle will be back, hopefully after a good showing at the World Cup. You are hoping that after the break we're going to fly, but it's a bad run of form
I'll be honest with you, mate, and I've been thinking about this the last couple of weeks. If I was on here last week, right, talking after the Aberdeen game, if we'd done one after the Aberdeen game, I'd have said to you, I don't think we're a million miles away from being the finished article. I think we're a good striker away from putting teams away. However, I've been thinking about it, right? You bring Nisbet back into that squad, it's about how do you embed him? Because Maloney couldn't do it. I don't think Jack Ross utilised them very well. The tail at the start of the year when he had them at the first part of the tenure before he got the sack. And McGeady couldn't embed him as well because there's no service to him. Like we could not get the ball under Maloney to Kevin Nisbet to put in the back of the net. Nisbet was having to try to get chances. And this crossing into the ball nonsense, like, he's not going to benefit for that. Nisbet benefits for fast flowing football through the middle. Ball in at his feet, ball in behind. But I have been thinking, I mean, I watched that Aberdeen game and I thought we were great. I watched the St Mirren game, I thought we were brilliant. I thought the press was really, really good. And I thought, do you know what? Like, we're almost there. Like, we're a good striker away for, like, I mean, 9 shots on goal before Aberdeen scored. You've got a good strike and a Nisbet or something like that. You're taking at least one. You're hoping you're taking at least one with a striker to his quality. Do you know what I mean? And that turns the game on its head. And that can really change the trajectory of the game and our luck. But I do feel like we have been saying for the last 3 years ever since, we're a striker away from finishing. Well, you know, we used to say it, mate, go back and listen to a podcast for 2 years ago or something, and we'll say, okay, what, we're due someone a doing. We're due someone a doing. Someone's getting a doing. Nobody's getting a doing for us. We're the easiest team to play against. We're so one-dimensional. It's unbelievable. It is so boring. We must be the easiest team to play against. All we've got is you get the ball down to Cadden, passes it to Boyle. Boyle tries to beat two or three players, can he do it? Come again, get the ball down to Boyle. Boyle will cross it into the box. Or Cadden will cross it into the box. And that'll just, there's nobody there to attack it. There's nobody there. And it is the same thing. It's rinse and repeat. To get the ball out to the right-hand side and cross it in, repeat. And it's, Johnson has to sort that. And I'm starting to lose a bit of faith in him, to be honest with you. The tactics are shocking. What I've seen on Saturday there, and correct me if I'm wrong, like, but why are we crossing into the box like for the edge of the 18-yard box or like can out on the wing? Like, why not try and beat a player and run into the box with it and keep the ball at your feet? Then you get ready at the minute you're in the box. Keep the ball at your feet. If someone comes in and bangs into you or whatever, like, can cause a mistake. You've got the ball in a dangerous area. Then you get ready at it so quickly. But Henderson's doing that, and just to name a few, Newell as well, lashing at shots. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's poor, man. Very, very poor. They've no ideas, and you could see how desperate they were. It was actually embarrassing, man. They were claiming everything on VAR. They were desperate to get a VAR decision at the end of that match against Kelly. You know what I mean? That's one of the worst teams in the league. Poor, like, hey. But what do you think about? I know I'm ranting here because I've been thinking about it all week, but. What do you think about the fact that we're maybe not a million miles away from being the finished article because we are creating a lot of chances, we're just not taking them?
So,
is that rubbish, mate?
Can I go back to you said we need a striker, like we're not a striker would make all the difference, like Nisbet would make all the difference in that sort of situation?
Yeah,
I don't think it is. I think McCullough is good enough to score goals, we've seen it. I think he's got 4 goals in 10 if you add the.
Is he not 19 or something, though?
19 games?
No, 20.
Years old. Is he not, like, very young?
No, he's 21.
Is he, right? Okay.
But, like, McCall, like, he's a good, very good player. And we've seen that he'd be... I think if you look at the goals that are, like, offside, but, like, that's not him offside, he'd be on about 8. So, I don't necessarily think it's the striker that's the issue. I think it's the players around that. The boys making the final decisions... to put it into the box. So, for example, you're saying about the bot, like the crosses coming in from it. And what if we took, like as you said, take on a man, hit the byline, cross it in along the ground where the strikers are better. Like, they'll say, all our strikers are good with their feet. Try and place it in that corner. I don't, like, I agree that we're one piece away. I just don't agree it's a striker. I think it's.
Do you think it's a creative mid or something?
I think it's someone that can. Unlock that defence and people. I think one of my mates was saying about McGeady. I don't think McGeady's the answer either, just because I don't see it. Like, he's not played in months. When he comes back, it won't be a shot. I just don't see him being like that like driving force.
Yeah,
but definitely the like just a midfield, someone like a same Scott Hallen that's like
on him again, someone who can put their foot in the line. Drive forward through the middle.
No, I do agree. We're like one missing piece. I just don't think that piece is a striker because I think we've got 3-4 quality strikers. I just don't think we're getting the ball to them.
I think as well, like the formation as well. Like the formation's changed so often, like the past couple of weeks. And I know that's probably down to McGuinness being injured. Rocky's just back, so Johnson wants to shoehorn him in the team, which I don't agree with personally, but. Like, we need a consistent formation, and I think, obviously, Johnson, when he came in, Calvin, when we spoke to him back in June, I think it was, end of May, beginning of June, he said that he's not a formation-style manager, he's more of a system, which is fine and well, but when you're lacking goals, you need a system that's going to try and get goals, and I don't think we have that just now. And obviously, when McGeady coming back in, time will tell if he'll even play. I don't think he'll feature much, to be honest. I think it's another waste of money. We've got like McCurdy's there, Bojang is there. If we need him, I don't think we will. We've got strikers that can score, but we're definitely lacking in the midfield department, and that's That's probably something that needs to be addressed in January, I'd say. We need a creative midfield, even if it's a creative centre mid. Like, we've got a creative attacking mid in McGuinness, who, for all intended purposes, is made of glass. And
he's finished, man. He's finished.
As bad as it sounds, I think for Kyle's sake, he should retire. Because he's had two games and he's back out again. Like, oh, hopefully it's just a 2-week injury, like Johnson says, but if he gets another dull one, that'll probably be him done. Hibs, at least. Maybe no football, but... Because it's hard to justify keeping someone on the wages that is that injury prone, you know?
Yeah.
But, yeah. Obviously, like, going forward, we'll look ahead at Jack. Like, obviously, we've got this 5-week break now, which is great. I think it's come at the right time. So, looking ahead after the break, we've got Rangers away. We've got Livingston at home. We've got Celtic at home. Then we've got Hearts away. Four games that come at the worst possible time for us. So I'll come to you first, Calvin. How many points in those four games do you realistically see us taking? Bearing in mind we'll have Nisbet and McGee Day and all that back.
What did Ryan Porter say? Didn't he ask silly questions? You know what I mean? How could I tell you the answer to that? That's probably the hardest. Rangers away, that's a loss. Going off right now.
Going off the way we're now,
we're not winning any of those games. We're losing to Rangers, we're losing to Livingston, we're losing to Celtic, we're losing to Hearts. Something needs to change, and it needs to change quick. Because if we can't beat the poorest teams in the league, we just had a run of games that we should have picked up near enough maximum points. St Johnstone getting beat 2-1 at home for St Johnstone.
Should have won.
Beat St Mirren. 4-1 away to Aberdeen. It's never a 4-1 game in your life. We should have won that. We should have had that wrapped up in the first half. We lost 2-0 at Ross County and we just lost to Kilmarnock. So how, after losing to those teams who are the worst teams in the league, including ourselves who are shite and all, how can we then say confidently we're going to go beat second place Rangers, we'll beat Livingston, who are a fantastic team, beat Celtic at home, no chance, especially with VAR as well. Yeah, we've got to beat Celtic Rangers, I don't, and Hearts away, we'll get pumped silly. So I will say 0 points, but Hibs are that stupid, Hibs are honestly that stupid, and they show up in the big games, we're likely to take 6 points for that, 6 or 9 points for that, that's how stupid we are. We'll take 6 or 9 points for that, and then we'll get beat off a Motherwell the following week.
Right,
and
hard.
Dundee United, we'll lose to them.
It's hard to disagree.
That seems to be in the tail of our story so far. Picking up results against teams that maybe we shouldn't have, or you know what I mean? But yes, it's a scary time ahead. We just had a very easy ride and we didn't make the most of it. Yeah. And like Johnson said, too many missed opportunities. Like they need to seriously get their head together.
Aye. Aidan, same question to yourself, mate. How many points in the next four do you reckon?
One.
Draw at Tynecastle. That's not the one I thought you were going to say.
No, that's all. But we're really cool because we'll get beat by Livy. The old forms are right off. Like, I know it's stupid.
Be sure.
But you shouldn't be saying that. And that's
no,
the thing.
I know.
No, I'm just taking the mic.
I'm gonna say, under Lennon, we would never go into an old. I can't remember we were going into an old firm game thinking we wouldn't try and get something from it.
That's the mad hybe there. take off that Aiden mask. It's the mad hybe underneath. I get it. Neil Francis Lennon.
But it's true.
What, like, a hero, man. What a hero.
You definitely have to question the mentality of the team just now. And not even like, and it's been years. Like, a lot of blame gets put on the manager. A lot of people got put the blame on GR. A lot of people put the blame on Maloney. The blame's now shifting to Johnson, but that's three different managers, same group of players, not the same group entirely. A lot of the same core. Hanlon, Stevenson, Newell, who else? Who am I missing here? Who were they under Maloney and
Boyle to an extent?
Yeah, Boyle to an extent. These boys were like. I said just said a core, but that's not a core, but there's like a good few players.
Nah, you're bang on the money with what you're saying, mate. We know what you're meaning.
It's so annoying and frustrating. Like, I don't have, like, I think this is the first podcast I've been on I don't have words to say because I'm just that, like, frustrated with it.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, we can't keep chopping change of manager. We can't keep this cycle of players, like 22 players in two windows is mental. So where, like, you're right, I think Calvin said earlier, where did you put the blame? And I'll blame the dog.
Listen, let me tell you something, right? Too far. Listen, like I said to you earlier, the dogs want Alec McLeish back in. Yeah, McLeish. If anyone else has got any pug puns, get them sent to @StrongOpsHibs on Twitter. That's a good part of that. Been a rough time for Hibs. Rough.
Right, before this descends into chaos, I'm going to ban because we're running out of time here. But I agree with what users. I think we'll get 0 points. I think we'll get pumped in every game. Livy will come and turn us over big time, as they always do. But just a few things before we wrap up. So Hibs are just about to release a half-season ticket. I know it's probably the worst time to release a half-season ticket when we're playing this bad. But anyway, if you go on the Hibs website, I think it's tomorrow it's coming out. They told us earlier on. And you're going to get all the big games, including your half-season ticket, including the split after the 33 games are done. So well worth it. Maybe a Christmas present for a loved one, if you want to inflict that on them. Shame on you. But this will be one of two episodes this week. We'll be back on Wednesday night with women's team general manager Chris Gaunt, and he'll be joining us to talk about the women's team and look ahead to the cup final. So, make sure to tune in for that. And until next time, come on, Hibs.